Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 4407 in the name of Pam Gosell on congratulating Scottish Universities on Research Excellence Framework 2021 results. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Pam Gosell to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Ms. Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm honoured to be holding my second member's business debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, celebrating Scotland's status as a world-leading research nation. I would like to start by thanking University Scotland and Scotland's Rural College for sending briefings ahead of this debate. I would also like to congratulate St Andrews University on ranking top of the Guardian's 2023 University Guide and on being named Scottish University of the Year in the Times Good University Guide 2023. When I first submitted this motion, I was delighted to learn that around 85% of research submitted by Scottish universities is considered world-leading or internationally excellent in its quality. It is particularly impressive that every single one of Scotland's universities was found to be undertaking world-leading research. The research power behind Scotland's universities is immense, and it is this that is driving force behind many policy developments that help to identify and respond to socio-economic challenges facing Scotland, the UK and the world. One such example is the joint partnership between Scotland's Rural College and the University of Edinburgh, which retains its position as the strongest provider on agriculture, food, veterinary sciences in the UK. All 11 case studies submitted, 8 of which involve SRUC, were considered world-leading. These range from topics such as refined greenhouse gas reporting to barley disease management, all of which promotes sustainable growth for Scotland's natural economy. It is all not only the UK that stands to benefit from the Scotland's research contributions. As convener of the cross-party group on India, I have learned a great deal about international research collaborations. The University of Dundee, the University of Glasgow and the City of Glasgow College are all involved in the Clean Up Ganga case study, which involves mapping and monitoring water quality in the Ganga. This research will make a fantastic contribution to the environment in India, but it will also create transferable knowledge that can be shared and learned from at home and across the globe. Let's not forget, research helped us through the pandemic, and every day it helps cure diseases as well as identifying new ones. Research finds solutions to problems and problems to solutions. It is estimated that for every £1 million of public investment in Scottish university research, £8 million is generated in economic output. Whether that be through creating growth in emerging industries, job creation or attracting foreign direct investment. It is clearly an attractive area of investment. University of Scotland has a bold ambition to take innovation partnerships with SMEs across the UK to the next level. This is a necessary step for businesses responding to unpredictable or slow growth markets, but is also a must for any sustainable economic growth. There is an appetite for Scotland's world-leading research capabilities, but we must be there to capitalise on them. We cannot let this be a missed opportunity. The SNP Green National Economic Transformation Strategy claims to want to transform the economy, but that message is not being translated into action yet. There has been cuts to funding such as a 31% real terms cut in the Research Excellence Grant 2014 since, a projected 37% real terms cut to the teaching grant by 2024, and a 2,325 drop in funding per Scottish student since 2014. And it's with statistics like these that Scotland is losing its competitive edge on English universities. In contrast to Scotland, England's quality research grant is forecast to increase by over 10% in cash terms between 2021 and 2023. Universities are increasingly being asked to do more with less. The university funding model is on its knees. It is set to more reliant on international tuition fees than on the SNP government, which is a high-risk strategy. But I believe if the Scottish Government want to see true transformation and growth, then they need to acknowledge that. We need to see investment. To lose our competitive edge in research and development would be to lose one of the most attractive areas of investment in our economy. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, despite our reigning status as a world-leading research nation and financial constraints facing universities risk stunting growth, this SNP government must find a way to not only support but to champion an academic research. And I, just like everybody else here in the chamber, I'm keen to work cross-party towards a solution. Going forward, I hope that the Scottish Government consider the ask from bodies such as University Scotland and look toward an economic return of such an investment. As the saying goes, there is no research without action and no action without research.
Thank you very much, Ms Gosell. We now move to the open debate. I call first CoCab Stewart to be followed by Stephen Kerr for around 4 minutes, Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Pam Gosell for allowing the Parliament to reflect on the remarkable success of Scottish universities with this motion. In contributing to this debate, I would like to highlight the successes of the Universities of Glasgow and Strathclyde in particular, both located within my own constituency of Glasgow Kelvin. Glasgow has been ranked 13th in the Research Excellence Framework rankings of 129 institutions and Strathclyde 33rd. These are highly credible performances, and both universities should be proud of their performance, achieved with intense focus and effort on the part of the staff, who we know also to have busy teaching timetables and student welfare responsibilities. The University of Glasgow's achievement is particularly exceptional, and I want to pay tribute to the university leadership team for its vision and commitment, and to researchers who have delivered this result for the University of Glasgow and Scotland. Before the summer recess, I visited myself the breathtaking new Mazumdar Shaw Advanced Research Centre, known as the ARC. The new building is central to Glasgow University's research strategy. Moreover, the unique concept of creating world-changing research which contributes to solving global challenges is a huge credit to the institution and its academics. As you may know, the Advanced Research Centre brings together over 500 leading researchers in a building specifically designed to break down organisational structures, facilitate collaboration, and provide true societal impact. By housing such diverse teams within the same building, the ARC exposes individuals and researchers to areas and each other so they can collaborate. And it increases opportunities for interdisciplinary work on global challenges. It has exceptional features and accommodation, and I encourage everyone to go and visit it because the ground floor is open to the public at all times. The fact that the university has achieved this remarkable ranking while also delivering widening access to students from Scotland's most deprived areas and achieving a ranking of 19 out of 1,046 international institutions in the world for its positive impact on society in the Times Higher Education Impact Rankings earlier this year, it makes it all the more impressive. Turning to Strathclyde University, I'd like to note the quality of Strathclyde University's research and its impact, which has actually been recognised as the Scottish Government's significant investment in university ventures, such as the Advanced Forming Research Centre and the Continuous Manufacturing and Crystallisation. It's also reflected in Strathclyde's leading role in national centres, including the National Centre for Manufacturing Institute Scotland and the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre. In finishing, I do want to sound just a wee note of serious concern. Brexit may not yet have dealt a hammer blow to research in Scottish universities, but we read earlier this year that one of Scotland's top cancer experts is considering moving a major research project abroad amid political turmoil and warnings that a Brexit-linked impasse over EU funding will starve universities of talent. In July this year, the Herald newspaper reported that Dr. Payam Gamage, who works at the Cancer Research UK Beatson Institute in Glasgow, warning that the UK's departure from the £80 billion Horizon Europe programme is accelerating the UK's decline as a global centre for scientific excellence. He also said that development would significantly reduce Scotland's appeal to overseas researchers and stressed that it was already proving impossible to attract applications from EU states. And this isn't what Scotland voted for. I would like to close on a note of hope that Scotland will return sooner rather than later to the EU's valuable collaborative institutions and safeguarding the ongoing excellence of our university's research input and output. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Stewart. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Michelle Thompson again for around 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I think we should measure what CoCab Stewart has said against the actions of this SNP Green Scottish Government. But before I get to that, can I congratulate Pam Gosle on bringing this subject, this debate, to the Chamber tonight. And I'd also note this is the first time that I've had the privilege of addressing the Chamber in my new capacity as our education spokesperson. As noted by Pam Gosle, there is world-leading research and development happening right here in Scotland, and it helps Scotland and the rest of Britain to tackle social and economic challenges and much else besides the real challenges that we're facing in this ever-dynamic and changing world, which is why protecting and growing Scotland's research capabilities should be of utmost importance to everyone within this Parliament. Now, the SNP and the Greens may talk in a way which gives the impression that they understand this importance, but the reality of their actions show us that they do not. Ahead of today's Education, Children and Young People's Committee meeting, University Scotland submitted evidence which said by 2024-25, universities' teaching grant will have been cut by 34.7% in real terms over 10 years, and the research budget will have been cut by 41%. Let those numbers sink in. By 2024-25, our university's teaching grant cut by 34.7% in real terms over 10 years, the research budget cut by 41%. The Scottish Funding Council submitted evidence to the same committee which highlighted that the average annual research funding gap in Scotland from 2015-16 to 2018-19 was £328 million. Now that's a gap of SNP Green credibility. When they talk about our excellence in our universities and when they talk about excellence in our research capabilities. And an analysis of UKRI, the UK Research and Innovations Industrial Strategy Challenge Fund, shows that only 6.5% of the funding went to Scotland, compared with 44.2% going to London and the southeast of England. This is also a commentary on things as they are today. Collectively, this evidence shows that the success of research at Scotland's universities, highlighted by the motion, is not because of Scottish Government policy, but despite it.
Minister.
He refers to the amount of money drawn down through UKRI. Would he also reflect on the fact
that universities overall win around 13% of the UK's project-based research funding, with around 8% of the UK's population. And will he also tell us, given I think the suggestion is he thinks more money should be invested, where precisely that money should come from in the Scottish Government's budget?
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I'm supporting the motion, Minister, if it helps you understand where I'm coming from. I'm supporting the motion that complements and praises Scotland's universities' research capabilities and performance. However, I think what I am saying, Deputy Presiding Officer, very clearly, I hope, to everyone's understanding, is that the SNP Scottish Government has much to answer for in its stewardship of Scotland's universities' research funding. I will, yes.
Michael Marr.
Wait, the Minister, I suppose, in his intervention, will be well aware that actually in 2014, Scotland captured up to 15% of UKRI funding across the whole of the UK. It has dropped by 2.5% in the interim period, as exactly as a direct consequence of the funding gaps that Mr Kerr is highlighting.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm very grateful to Michael Marr for bringing these facts to the attention of the Chamber. World-leading research and development spurs innovation, invention and improvements in the Scottish economy. In fact, it's only a few months ago, Deputy Presiding Officer, that the Finance Secretary, Kate Forbes, brought to the Chamber and launched a transformative plan for Scotland's economy. And the truth is, at the centre of that plan are the centres of excellence in Scotland's universities, which will, by and by, create high-paid jobs, sustainable economic growth and competitive advantage to Scotland. But by cutting Scotland's research budget, the SNP are not only putting Scotland's world-leading research sector at risk, but cutting opportunities to create high-paid jobs in Scotland, cutting opportunities to create sustainable economic growth in Scotland, and cutting opportunities to give Scotland that competitive advantage in a global economy. Deputy Presiding Officer, I will conclude by simply asking, is this what they call being stronger for Scotland? I don't think so. Rather than continue with their financial cuts to research in Scotland and putting the sector at risk, the SNP should recognise the mistakes they are making. Rather than continue to cut opportunities, the SNP should be developing an ambitious plan that puts Scotland at the forefront of R&D within various fields, such as pharmaceuticals, industrial machinery, computer technology, agriculture and green energy. And the funding the Scottish Government provides must match the ambition of the plan. We cannot become complacent. I can see I'm testing the patience of the Deputy Presiding Officer. He thinks I've taken enough time, and I probably have. I will simply conclude by saying this, that Scottish universities' research deserves better than it gets from this SNP Scottish Government.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Kerr. I now call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Martin Whitfield again for around 4 minutes. Ms Thompson.
Presiding Officer, this place has a tradition of members' debates that are not overtly political, rather to focus on shared agreement and celebration of shared cross-party interests, and that's what I intend to do in my short remarks. Scotland's universities have achieved so much that is internationally excellent and world-leading, and this brings significant benefits for society. I have a very long active long COVID community group in Falkirk East, and the international study into long COVID led by the University of Glasgow, along with the World Health Organization, is likely to be of practical benefit to our understanding of the complexity of the condition. One of the characteristics of university research that is sometimes overlooked is the extent to which it involves working with others, as the University of Glasgow working alongside the World Health Organization demonstrates. The University of Stirling in particular deserves great praise, not least because it's close to my constituency and many of my constituents have benefited from undergraduate and postgraduate studies. Indeed, some of the postgraduate research students contribute directly to its research excellence, and I know their local MSP, Evelyn Tweedy, is disappointed she's currently unwell and missing this debate. I want to note in particular that the University's Institute of Aquaculture is ranked first in the UK for impact, with 100% of its research achieving the highest possible rating. It too has had huge links to other organisations in search of impact. The late Professor James Muir, after 30 years at the Institute, moved to a post with the United Nations, and in one of his last international assignments, he reviewed the Benguela Current Commission based in Namibia. Testimony to both his and the university's global standing. I also have a connection to Stirling University, in which regard I must point to my register of interest and my role as a director of the humanitarian organisation Revive Campaign. We currently have two University of Stirling postgraduate students conducting research for us. One, considering the impact of the war in Ukraine from a humanitarian standpoint, and the other, researching how humanitarian policies interact with the United Nations Development Goals. In so many ways, our university research capability has profound practical benefits for society. And as we look to the future, my contention is the role of university-based research will be of even greater critical importance. The world we live in today is changing faster than ever before. Most of the scientific and technological changes have been reliant on university research, and such changes have had impacts on both our wider social and cultural lives. In the future, research-based change will be even faster. The late Professor Tom Stonier, dubbed by some as the Professor of the Future, pointed out in the 1990s that in the last 25 years of the 20th century, there will have been more people working in frontline research than the entire earlier history of the world, fueling accelerating change. Things have continued to develop, making research the most fundamental need for any society with ambitions to make progress. Scotland needs to hold fast to her ambition and continue to invest in our university research base despite taxing economic times. Our very future depends on it.
Thanks very much indeed, Ms Thompson. I now call Martin Whitfield, to be followed by Michael Marra again, around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
Can I thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I also thank Pam Gosal for bringing this motion before us. And it's a great pleasure to follow Michelle Thompson's contribution, and I echo her final words of the importance of research for the future, not just here in Scotland, but for the future of the whole planet, because it's in research where so many of the answers that we are desperately seeking, and indeed we sometimes shout about in this chamber, may well indeed be found in a possibly more rational location by those who apply their minds. But the university research here in Scotland is, of course, world-leading. We've heard that. The £1 million the Scottish Government invests in university research has generated a return of £8 million. Indeed, the return from UKRI funding is £12 million. The results for Scottish universities, based on 21,256 research outputs, 8,675 academic staff across 18 institutions, speak for themselves. We have heard about the 41% of research that is four-star, that is world-leading. The 44% that is internationally excellent, three-star, submitted across all areas. 50% of research judged as world-leading or internationally excellent. This demonstrates the excellence across our country. But what does that mean in the hard realities? Well, for the Chamber's information, there are apparently 31,097 universities and higher education institutes across the world. The USA has 3,216. Australia, 190. Canada, 387. China, 2,565. And across the United Kingdom, 280. But what does that reality look like for people who get up in the morning and go out to work? Well, here in Scotland, Edinburgh University's research, world-leading, changed the age of criminal responsibility for us. And now we have the lowest number of young people in prison since 1972. At a UK level, Edinburgh research saved the NHS £2 billion across 6 years by improving stroke prevention. Around the world, the university research has saved 1 million children's lives from pneumonia, led to the banning of corporal punishment in schools and across several South American countries. And apparently there are 175 million smartphones, faster, greener, and ready for the complex demands of tomorrow and 5G because of Edinburgh University. But it is a reality, and it is a challenge, but I think it does need to be addressed here, that the excellence here in Scotland is narrowing when compared with the rest of the UK. And there is funding pressures. Despite a sector best performance, 8 universities in Scotland saw their research funding cut in spring this year following the RAF results due to insufficient investment in the Research Excellence Grant, the REG, as allocated by the Scottish Funding Council. Four of our highest performing universities saw their cuts of greater than £1 million. And as Ian Gillespie, Principal and Vice-Chancellor at the University of Dundee, wrote, well, where does this leave a university like Dundee, mid-sized Scottish research-intensive university? And the answer, he said, is the squeezed middle, that group of institutions which, despite excellent overall results in REF, including outstanding results in some areas, have received significant reduction in REG funding from the SFC. And that is a challenge going forward. It is a challenge for this SNP Green Scottish Government, because the challenge, as we heard from Michelle Thompson, is if that we don't fund research, if we don't fund both applied research to move things forward, but also the blue sky thinking that is needed, Scotland's future is looking grim. So is the UK's, and so is the world, because it is in our researchers, both the scientists, the engineers, the technologists, these whole teams that gather together to solve some of the hardest problems we face, and some that truly do sit around and think the impossible and make it possible. We have a very dim future going forward. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whitfield. I now call Michael Marr, the final speaker in the open debate, again around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Pam Gosol for bringing the debate to the Chamber. It's right that we have the opportunity to celebrate the research culture and outputs and from our universities. I mean, it is an ancient but enduring strength of Scotland that Martin Whitfield has rightly highlighted, but something that we have to treasure and hold as a delicate treasure of our country. I'm proud to represent a region with four, in particular, outstanding universities in Aberdeen, Robert Gordon University, the University of Abertay and the University of Dundee. I want to make my mention before I talk about projects or the general issues to actually the professional staff who work in the universities, frankly, for whom the REF process, as they know it, is an absolute nightmare. It's not an enjoyable process. It takes many, many hours filling in complex case studies, producing evidence to be assessed. And we owe them our thanks as well for the fantastic standings that our universities and that we're all here tonight to celebrate. But those universities and those individuals don't do any of this alone. Research in universities is fundamentally a collaborative process. It's done with partners and other institutions, both across the UK and internationally. And we don't have to look further than what we saw in terms of the COVID pandemic for the rapid production of vaccines. Thank you, Martin. Vaccines within our universities, when people can collaborate across borders. And actually, some of the barriers to that collaboration were brought down, hopefully forever, in that process, in terms of preprint publications, rapid dissemination of the results of testing, so that we can actually have human benefit rather than intellectual property as a result of the outputs of our publicly funded institutions. And COCAB Stewart was right, I believe, to highlight Brexit. And Brexit in itself has been a fundamental attack on that culture of collaboration. We should not walk away or dismiss the ideas, and I don't think anybody in this chamber would, the challenges that that brings. The fact that access to the European institutions and their fantastic resource and different cultures of research, I mean, the barriers that have been put up to that as a result of Brexit, because it's Brexit. It's about sharing knowledge, making sure there is open access to that information. I know colleagues across universities whose careers have been fundamentally damaged by that process, who were funded through European funding and projects. It's a different track of funding, a different way, Presiding Officer, of gaining resource, and to actually have that removed, I think, has ruined some careers in Scotland and right across the UK. And frankly, it's a shameful that it has done so. The sooner you're right in terms of full access to those collaborations, the better. But COCAB Stewart, and I know SNP members, have to reflect in that about not putting up barriers to collaboration. And in the spirit of Michelle Thompson's point in terms of not being too political, I won't go much further in that respect. But if we're going to make sure that we have a continued collaboration, that has to be at the forefront of the minds of SNP members, to make sure that barriers are not put up to how we work across these islands either. I would also say, though, it does not serve this Parliament well not to highlight the challenges that we have. I know the Minister will respond to this in his closing remarks. We had this very morning at Education Committee the reflections of Professor George Boyne, the Principal of the University of Aberdeen, who was drawing attention to the long-term trends of decline where we are. So in this REF, in the REF figures that we are celebrating today, English universities, Welsh universities, our UK universities have improved their performance at a faster rate than Scottish universities have. That's the challenge in truth for us as a parliament and as parliamentarians, that if we're going to safeguard that ancient and fantastic culture of research that we have in this country, we have to do better, and we have to have a long-term and hard look at how we make sure that those trends do not scupper our universities in the years to come. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Mara. I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Hitler.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I also begin by thanking Pam Gosnell for bringing forward this debate by tabling the motion that she laid before. Part of this has been a very useful opportunity for us to reflect on and celebrate the many successes of Scotland's academic institutions and their research strengths. We know that we have a world-class research base here in Scotland, and the new knowledge and insights that they produce are fundamental to our ongoing recovery and growth. Can I also add my congratulations, as Pam Gosnell did, to St Andrews and the news that they received in recent days. Can I thank members for their contributions? I'll try and respond to as many as I can, but his contribution this evening allows me to welcome Mr Kerr to his new role as Conservative Education spokesperson. I look forward to his ongoing constructive contribution to discourse on all matters educational. I'm sure I can rely on him in that regard. But returning to the subject matter this evening, Presiding Officer, the Research Excellence Framework results that we saw recently fundamentally demonstrate that there is much to be celebrated in Scottish research, and our success does not just rely on a few institutions. Scottish university research is world-class right across the board. There is evidence of world-leading research in every single university in Scotland. That is something that we should laud and celebrate and make every effort to highlight, and I thought Martin Whitfield laid out some of that in detail, so I won't rehearse what he had to say, but I would absolutely.
Martin Whitfield.
Just as much as a point of clarification, because of course here in Scotland we have Open University Scotland, whose research is actually attributed to Open University as a whole rather than separate and distinct and resting in the Scottish figures.
Minister.
Well, indeed, and I would reflect that the Open University in Scotland, who I have regular dialogue with, are a very much valued part of the landscape of higher education here in Scotland. I want to also join Michael Mara in acknowledging the, because we can talk about this in generic terms, the achievements of our universities, but all those achievements rely on the individual contribution of people working day in and day out in research in the various disciplines that they work in, so I want to join him in thanking those individuals. And that research is allowing us as a nation to make significant breakthroughs on some of the biggest challenges and opportunities that we also face. Scottish researchers are driving innovations in the way we treat cancer and dementia. They're developing solutions that address the climate emergency and child poverty. They are bringing new knowledge that transforms our healthcare, technology, environmental sustainability and more. And of course, they also played a critical role in reorientating and gearing much of their research activity during the COVID-19 period to make sure that we were responding to the challenges we face. So it's unsurprising, therefore, that REF results show almost 90% of our impact judged to be outstanding or very considerable. And I should say to CoCab Stewart, I've been able to see firsthand how Scottish research changed lives at the University of Glasgow, and I visited the research into inflammatory arthritis centre with Versus Arthritis. I met the world-leading researchers advancing our understanding of the causes of rheumatoid arthritis, which we know affects over 400,000 adults in the UK, 44,000 here in Scotland. And that underlines the impact it can have on people's real lived experience, and it also speaks to that partnership approach that Michelle Thompson spoke of. And I can say that I have seen examples of that world leading research at all the various institutions I have mentioned. Briefly, yeah.
Stephen Kerr.
The Minister has a tremendous responsibility because it's in his stewardship to see that the numbers that were quoted this morning from University of Scotland about this real terms cut in the research budget over 10 years of 41% is reversed. Will the Minister tell us what he's going to do to fight that much harder to make sure that this investment in Scotland's future is increased on his watch?
Minister.
Well, I'll come on to talk about the figures, but I guess that was a reference to the recent Research Excellence Grant Awards. I should say that has always been a competitive process. That has not changed, and by any the nature of any competitive process, some may benefit more by that award than others. But what I would want to place on record is that that process was, that model was shaped with consultation with the sector itself. But I want to go back to the point I was about to make, because both Cocab Stewart and Michael Mara spoke of the impact of Brexit, and that is a concern to me. And I want to assure all members that this government is absolutely committed to making sure that there are no barriers to research. And to underline that point, I was very happy to go just this morning to an event at the University of Edinburgh with UNA Europa, a coalition of European universities stretching across the continent, underlying the international approach we have in Scotland. And I reaffirmed that as an approach that I very much support and the Scottish Government values. In terms of the research base we have, and this really speaks to some of the figures because some have been bandied about, what wasn't placed on record and now enables me to do so is that for all the points that have been made, and I do take them seriously, Scotland still ranks seventh amongst the OECD countries for higher education research and development spend as a percentage of GDP. That's above the EU average, that's above the OECD average, and it's well above the UK average as well. And we are continuing to invest nearly £300 million in research and innovation for this year. That's an increase from last year. We spent £3 million on our Saltire Research Awards last year, supporting 200 projects between Scotland and Europe. That all contributes towards a wealth of research activity and enables them to leverage additional resource, enabling Scotland to win around 13% of UK's project-based research funding, again with 8% of the UK's population, as I mentioned a few moments ago. Scottish institutions win around 12% of the overall research grants and contracts from EU government bodies secured by the UK. Scottish organisations over the period 2014 to 2020 won €874 million from Horizon 2020, around 11% of the overall UK winnings under that programme. So we are punching above our weight, and just in that particular programme, and I'll give, if I'm able to, I'll give way to Mr Mara in a moment, but that is a particular area of concern because there have been suggestions about the concerns of the Scottish Government's investment. The concern right now is that we have a UK Government that is ready to take us out of the Horizon 2020 programme, a programme that delivered nearly £900 million Euros of investment from 2014 to 2020, above the UK performance here to Scotland. Do I have time to give way?
I can give you the time back, Minister. Michael Mayer.
Thank you, Presiding. Thank you to the Minister for giving way. I think his point about punching above our weight is well made. I'd made my intervention earlier about the declining trend in that regard. But can I highlight the University of Dundee's performance in biomedical sciences? Number one university in the UK, the whole of the UK for biomedical sciences, life sciences that will drive the future of the Scottish economy, better than any but Cambridge or Oxford. But the question remains that, put by Professor Ian Gillespie, that performance was actually punished. That performance resulted in a cut to the Reg funding to the University of Dundee. What does the Minister have to say to those universities that performed outstandingly, astonishingly in fact, and have had their resources cut as a result?
Minister.
Well, I think it's silly to talk about in terms of universities being punished. We have a competitive system where institutions take forward put forward their work. It is assessed under the the framework and grants are therefore awarded. What this has reflected is we've seen an overall uplift in terms of the quality of research. That's something to be celebrated, and I would have thought Mr Mara would have wanted to join in that celebration. Let me conclude, Presiding Officer, by saying again I am enormously grateful for all the activity that is undertaken the length and breadth of the country in our academic institutions. We should be proud of that effort. We should talk at every opportunity about that effort. There is so much work that's going on out there that is to be welcomed, and I would encourage all members to get out to their local institution to see some of it for themselves. I can certainly tell you, President Officer, I make it a core part of my activities to get out there and to celebrate all of Scotland's wonderful research through our academic institutions.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. I can assure you and the Chamber I'll be attending the UHI graduation ceremony in the coming days. But with that, that concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.